Okay, hello everyone. We can start now. So this is week 8. So if you have any question, you can ask. Like for the internet, what we have discussed so far is that like how to communicate between two machines, right? And for that purpose, we require different addresses. And similarly, what is the purpose of transport layer? Who will tell? Transport layer. Yeah.
It's to transmit data from one to another.
Okay. And what are the important protocols of transport layer? Yeah, TCP and UDP, right? So, So basically, transport layer manages like process to process communication, okay? And then for last 2 weeks, we are discussing networks layer, right? In which the important device is, what is the important device that we use in networks layer? Yeah, router. Okay. So if this local area network of NUIG wants to connect with outside world, they need a very important device named as router. Okay. So you can imagine that like all local area networks are connected with each other with routers. Just like if you are taking some broadband or some internet service from the ISP. So technically you are connected with that ISP through one router, okay? And by this way, similarly, this local ISP would be connected with some regional or national level ISP with another router or couple of routers, right? And then this regional or national ISP would be connected with some international ISP with the help of routers. So if I want to send data from here to US, it means that there would be multiple routers that would be creating different routes to send my data from NUIG to, let's suppose, New York in US, right? So for last 2 weeks, we were discussing this network layer, which is very important. So if you want to communicate outside the world, you need this layer, right? You need routers, because routers are responsible to create a path between sender and receiver, okay? And similarly, then they would send your data to the right router. So after the network layer, the last layer, the important one layer, is link layer, okay? And this link layer is about local area network, like how I will send my data from this laptop to this Wi-Fi router. Okay, don't confuse with actual router and the name Wi-Fi router. Okay, Wi-Fi routers are part of link layer application. Okay, so for link layer, this Wi-Fi router is there, Ethernet switches are there. So switch, Wi-Fi router, is something else, but actual routers that are responsible for creating route between a sender and receiver is different, and they are part of network layer, okay? So only this layer is remaining, and then after link layer, we would have physical layer. And for physical layer, it means actual links, okay? Coaxial cables or optical fibers, they are physical media, right, on which you have to transfer data. So today we will start and discuss what is the main functionality of link layer. So we have application layer, which is basically responsible for getting data from the GUI of that application. So your WhatsApp, when you are opening your WhatsApp, technically it's communicating with the application layer of the network, okay? So or if you are using HTTP, or if you are browsing some website, surfing some website, then this application layer is responsible for collecting data and requesting particular data. So for application layer, we have HTTP, FTP, SMTP, DNS sort of thing. Then after application layer, we have transport layer, which is responsible for process-to-process communication, and TCP, UDP are the famous protocols for this layer. Internet uses TCP, okay? And we discussed this thing so many times because TCP is reliable and flow control is there, congestion control is there. Can anyone tell what is congestion control? Or what is the meaning of congestion in terms of the internet or networks? Congestion. What is the meaning of congestion?
Okay. Is that the overflow problem when too much data is sent to too many people?
Yeah, so just like a traffic jam, right? On a road, if you have hundreds or thousands of cars at a time, obviously it would be congestion at intersections, right? So just like over the internet, if there is some live streaming of some important matches going on, then obviously there would be congestion on that particular link, okay? So, and what is flow control? What is the meaning of flow control in terms of the internet? Flow control. Who will tell? From this side? Flow control. In simple English, forget about internet. What is the meaning of flow control? Water flow control, let's say.
They transmit to that.
Yeah, good. So obviously your sender and receiver have different capabilities. We cannot expect that the same hardware and software would be running at the receiving end, okay? So but if my machine or my computer is so fast, I cannot say that, okay, let's send data with the slowest ever possible rate. You don't know, right? So it means that, okay, you have to agree, both server and host or receiver should agree that, okay, this speed is okay for me to receive, okay? So this is flow control, and we read this thing in TCP, okay? TCP do this thing that receiver in one header, they send send information. This is the buffer size available at my end. So according to that, then sender will send that much data only for that particular time, okay? So we also discussed buffers. Routers are storing your data and then forwarding your data, right? And whenever their buffers are overflow, they will discard some data. That's why we lost data. Sometimes we can say that, okay, I have sent you an email, but there is a possibility that I really didn't get that email, right? So it is a possibility that particular data was lost during transmission. And during transmission means, because if my router memory is 1 GB, for example, then obviously if there is data coming more than 1 GB, I have to discard some data. I have to ignore some data, okay? So it means that by this way we can lose data, okay, in actual for internet communication. So in today's lecture we would be discussing the link layer, and this is the last layer that we would be discussing: application layer, transport layer, network layer, and the last one is link layer. And then obviously we have physical layer, but we are not covering as such in this course because it's just hardware sort of thing, and we don't want to memorize what is the sending capacity of optical fiber or coaxial cables, okay? So link layer. So obviously goal is to understand principles behind link layer services, error detection and correction, sharing a broadcast channel, multiple access, okay? So In local area networks, the transmission is broadcasting. Okay, you know, TV transmission is also broadcasting. They are not one-to-one sort of communication. They are broadcasting. Just like your 3G or 4G signals or your mobile signals, there is a one tower for one particular mobile operator, and they are just broadcasting. Okay, so broadcasting is that they are sending data to all. Okay, and then my devices would decide, okay, this data is for me or no. Okay, so for local area networks or for link layer, we also have addressing, and we discussed this thing before that MAC address, right, machine address. Always one network card would have one unique address, on based of that unique address, or known as machine address or MAC address, we can identify packets that are for that particular machine. And then there are different practices. Widely used practice for local area network is Ethernet. Okay, so it's not a protocol. Ethernet is not a protocol, but it's a standard, you can say that, or it's a common practice how to set up local area networks. Okay, then we have virtual LANs, data centers, MPLS sort of thing. So this is a picture of one or complete internet, right? And obviously we would be discussing this thing that we have host routers. We usually call this thing as nodes. And then communication channels that directly connect physically adjacent nodes, we call this thing as links. Okay, so physically adjacent means for this router and this router, they are physically adjacent nodes, right? So this link layer is about this communication, how to send data to physically adjusted or physically connected nodes. Okay, and it could be wired, it could be wireless, just like this Wi-Fi. All of the devices or computers in this room are directly connected to this Wi-Fi or router. There is another one there as well. So same is the case with local area networks. In one class I saw you this, there is a switch, right? Remember, there is a one device here. So this is for link layer, right? How many of you remember that there is a device in this cupboard, right? So it has all the cables that can be connected physically to these screens, and even if we have desktop computers, we can connect it just like this. Okay. So this is a switch, and from switch there would be a physical cable going on between each computer. Okay, this is a wired. Same is the case for this switch. For this wireless router, there would be a cable, and you can see this one, right? So it means that this one, this cable is connected with this one. This is a switch. So it would be here, this PC file. So it means that, okay, so communication is just like this, right? So this is your in-class Wi-Fi router, and for example, this is my laptop, right? So my laptop is connected through wireless network, but obviously this router, Wi-Fi router, is connected with one switch, and then this switch would be connected with NUIG router. Okay, and these routers are responsible to send data to US or Australia or any part of Europe or something, right? So in today's lecture, we are discussing about setting for this link layer application. Okay, how communication would be from this computer to this switch, or even I can send data to the same network. Okay, so this is local area networks. So layer 2 packets frame encapsulates datagram, right? So link layer has responsibility of transferring datagram from one node to physically adjacent. This is very important, physically connected node over a link. Okay. So framing link access, so just like this cable access sort of thing, for each house we have connection and then it would be connected with something, right? In terms of cellular and Ethernet LANs, Wi-Fi routers. So these are the main services of link layer. So encapsulates datagram into frame, adding header and trailer. And obviously when we are saying that every layer would have some data that would be added to the actual data, okay? And then channel access if shared medium. MAC addresses in frame headers identify source destination, okay? Different from IP address. So this MAC address, machine address, is important. If some data is going on this link, then on the basis of MAC address, it will know that, okay, this data is for this machine, not for this machine, okay? So reliable delivery between adjacent nodes, that's why we need some sort of correction, error detection sort of thing. Flow control is also there for link layer, just like a transport layer. Pacing between adjacent sending and receiving nodes. So same is the case, like it will see, okay, how much data can be transmitted at one time so that the receiver can easily receive that data, okay? So this is flow control. So flow control service is also there in link layer. Error detection, errors caused by signal attenuation sort of thing, or noise, okay? So receiver detects errors, signals retransmission and drops frame. And error correction is also one of the service of this link layer. And our links could be half duplex or full duplex. With half duplex, nodes at both ends of link can transmit, okay? But not at same time. In full duplex, both nodes at one end can send data simultaneously. But if the link is half duplex, then they have to wait, okay? So host link layer implementation is simple. For example, this is your computer and this device is a network card. This, every laptop has this network card, okay? Or some sort of Wi-Fi card is there. So in each and every host, link layer implemented on chip or in network interface card. So this link layer would be present in this network card, okay? And it will implement link and physical layer. So for example, okay, in the next. So it attaches into host system buses. What is a system bus in computer? Do you know? Within a computer, they have a bus, like just like a path, or it just like a resource to transmit data from one, from, for example, hard disk to RAM or RAM to network card. So they call it bus, okay? System buses. So attaches into host system buses, combination of hardware, software, and firmware, okay? So you can see that in CPU, it would be processing with the help of memory, application, and transport, right? But this link and physical would be in your NIC, network interface card, and they would be communicating through a system bus, okay? System bus, in simple, you can say that it's just to transfer data from one part of computer to another part of the computer, okay? So So datagram, then this link layer will add one frame. So sending side encapsulates datagram in frame, okay? Adds error checking bits, reliable data transfer, flow control, all the services just adding in this header. So another header would be added in datagram. So this datagram is coming from the network layer, okay? Because network layer is at the top. So then this is a frame, then this frame would be transferred through a physical medium, right? Physical medium in terms of my laptop, and this switch is wireless, okay? So then same is the case, it would be received by NIC or your network card of that your receiver. At the receiving side, it looks for errors, reliable data transfer, flow control, same things, right? Then it will extract datagram and passes to upper layer at receiving side. So it will use this link header, right? And it will see, okay, if there is any error or if there is any issue with some sort of flow control. Otherwise, it will just transfer this datagram to the upper layer by this way. So any question about link layer, functionality of link layer, or any confusion about overall functionality of the internet? Because this is the last lecture in terms of discussing layers. In the next week, we would be discussing overall picture of the internet so that we can revise each and every concept again in the first half of the class, and then we would be starting network security sort of thing or some other advanced topics of networks. So this is week 8, so there are only 4 weeks left, right? So 2/3 of the course would be ended after this lecture. Yeah. Transport layer and link layer?
Yeah.
Okay. So can anyone tell difference between transport layer and link layer? So technically, transport layer was host-to-host communication, right? We discussed, process-to-process communication, right? So it means that, for example, this machine wants to communicate with another machine in France, for example, okay? So transport layer is responsible for, and for example, I'm running Skype on this machine and I have a video call on Skype with someone in France, right? So it means that this Skype process here on this machine and Skype process in France have to link with each other, right? This sort of linkage, process linkage, would be handled by transport layer, okay? But to send data, my first task as a sender is to connect this machine with this machine. So whenever we are talking about adjacently or physically connected machines, then we need this link layer, okay? So and obviously, in terms of services, there are some sort of overlapping, just like flow control or reliable data transferability or some sort of error checking. But the concept is same, but this flow control is for this machine and this machine, not the end user machine, okay? So transport layer would be doing that work for end user and the sender, okay? But link layer is responsible for sending data from here to the physically connected next machine, okay? So in ideal situation, it could be same machine, but obviously we are talking about internet. It means that our data would be transferred over the internet and then it will find its receiver, okay? So we have two types of links, multiple access links, and we have two types of links, point to point, and point to point is point to point link between Ethernet switch and host, and PPP for dial-up access. This dial-up access is now almost obsolete, like 10 years ago or 20 years ago, you do require dial-up access services, but today there are few services for this dial-up sort of thing. So point-to-point or broadcast, okay? Shared wire or medium, okay? So just like your Ethernet is a link type of broadcast, it's not a point-to-point communication. So there are two types of links, point-to-point communication and broadcast, okay? So in point-to-point, your physical link is only directly Bluetooth. All of you know that Bluetooth services, right? It's a point-to-point or it's a broadcast service. What do you think? Bluetooth. When you want to transfer your data over Bluetooth link, it's a point-to-point or it's a broadcast? Any guess?
Point to
point, because remember you have to select your device, right? You have to create a connection between two devices, and that communication can only happen between two devices. It is not possible to it's not a broadcasting sort of thing, okay? So, but for Ethernet, for Wi-Fi, wireless LAN 802.11, this sort of thing, wireless LAN or your 4G or even 5G satellite signals, they are broadcasting sort of thing. So this is shared wire or cabled Ethernet, okay? Same is the case with shared radio signals, 4G, 5G mobile signals, right? So it's also broadcasting. Same is the case with Wi-Fi LAN, so broadcasting is there. Same is the case if you are getting signals from the satellite, it's also shared radio, okay? Just like humans at different party or something, they are using shared air, and just like I'm communicating with all of you by using some sort of broadcast mechanism, it's not like that. There is something direct link with each of you, okay? So multiple access protocol, single shared broadcast channel, two or more simultaneous transmissions by nodes. And obviously, if I am broadcasting something, there is a more possibility of collision, right? Because you can send data, I can send data, right? And obviously, that's why noise was created, right? Noise would be created because of collision. Because if node receives two or more signals at the same time, just like if I'm asking some question and all of you start speaking, then obviously it would become noise for me, right? So just same is the case with broadcast channel or for computers. If all computers are sending data, then obviously in multiple access protocols, there is a chance of collision. And for collision removal, we have very good protocols, CSMA, so it's very easy to detect collision and resend data. So distributed algorithm that determines how nodes share channel. So same channel, but it will determine, okay, if you want to send data, you have to check it. If there is no transmission going on, you can simply send it, okay? Over the Ethernet, this is the main protocol. Even it is possible that two machines simultaneously check that the medium is available and send data, but it could happen, and then there is a possibility of collision, and collision detection algorithm, this algorithm will detect collision, okay? So any question? So is it clear? This slide is clear? We are broadcasting. if we are broadcasting, there is a chance that multiple machines can send data simultaneously and it would become noise for me because I have to understand, right? So multiple access protocol is that firstly you have to check that that medium, no one is using that medium. If no one is using that medium, you can send data simply. Or then obviously if there is some data going on, then you have to wait a little bit, okay? So this is multiple access protocol. So we have different type of addressing, right? Because whenever we are communicating with this device to this device, we do require addressing, okay? So far what we have discussed for IP address is responsible for, and we use this IP address sort of thing in network layer, right? So because this computer needs one unique public IP address to communicate with another computer outside NUIG. Okay, that's why we need IP addresses. And obviously this machine would have one public IP address and receiver would have another public IP address so that they can both communicate, right? And similarly for processes, what would be the address? How this machine will differentiate that this data is for Skype process or Skype program, not for WhatsApp program, for example. Who will tell? Like if I am using surfing some data, right, on the web browser, why that data cannot be open on Skype interface? We discussed this thing so many times. Like, I can differentiate our IP addresses to send data from this machine to another machine. Okay, that's fine, data is there. Now, on that receiver end, on the basis of what they will decide, this data is for Skype, this data is for web browser, this data is for something else. How it will know that
port
machine.
Number.
Sorry?
The port number,
yeah. Okay. So port number is very important for this case. Okay. So port number is simply a virtual or abstract sort of number that is assigned to each process. When my Skype application is sending data, they would tell on destination you have to send this data to port number 2231, let's suppose, okay? So for destination, it will check port number, okay? This data is for this machine, that's fine. This IP address will determine this thing that this data is for this particular machine, but port number will decide, okay, this data is for Skype application or for the web browser, okay? So port number, IP addresses, and MAC addresses. So these are the three important addresses that must be there to communicate over the internet. So we discussed in IP version 4, we saw this thing that we have 32-bit IP address, and this address is more related with network layer, okay? Used for layer 3, network layer forwarding, just like 128.119.40136. So this is a public IP address, okay? So whenever you are writing facebook.com on the web browser, actually DNS would resolve this name, domain name, to this IP address, 128.1 thing. So this was the functionality of DNS to resolve name for you, because people cannot remember IP addresses of each websites. It's very easy to remember bbc.com or rte.ie something, but it's very, very difficult to remember this 32-bit IP address, right? But this sort of thing would be handled by DNS, okay? So DNS know that, okay, for that cnn.com, what is the IP address of cnn.com at the time, okay? So for this layer, for link layer, we also require another address other than 32-bit IP address. This is MAC, okay, machine address. And its function is to use locally to get frame from one interface to another physically connected interface, okay? So this link layer is about physically connected interfaces, okay? So 48-bit MAC address. Every computer has, or this NIC ROM device has, this 48-bit MAC address. Sometimes it's software settable, but most of the time it's burned. It's hardware setted, okay? So just like this one. And it should be unique all over the world for each address. So each interface on LAN has unique 48-bit MAC address. So if we are connected to this Wi-Fi, all of us would have one network card installed on our computer or laptop, and this network card would have unique 48-bit MAC address and has a locally unique 32-bit IP address, okay, as we have seen. So this is local area network or some sort of thing, right? But the communication would be through MAC addresses. MAC address allocation administered by IEEE. So manufacturer buys portion of MAC address space. So they acquire few ranges and then they have to use their range to create, and whenever they would be creating a new network card, they would be assigning one address to that network card. So MAC address is just like a PPS number, your unique PPS number, and IP address is your postal address. So it's just like if this building address is different, but if I want to send some data to room number 243, then this would be a MAC address. It is unique, at least if we consider this building as a world. So there should be only one room number having 243 so that data can come or post can come, okay? IP addresses cannot be portable, obviously, because we know that IP addresses are dependent on the router address or subnetting sort of thing. But this MAC address is portable. Like if I am the part of this NUIG, and for example, if I am visiting some other university, GMIT, and if I am connected to their network, that's no issue because same MAC address would be now part of that network, right? So whenever I am doing communicating by using their network. So that's why this MAC address is portable, but obviously IP address is not portable. You have to change your IP address when you would be entering into a new network, right? For example, IP address of your laptop right now would be totally different when you would be connecting your network in your home or something else, right? Or if you are using your mobile data, then that IP address would be different. So address resolution protocol is a famous protocol that would be used in link layer. And the main purpose of ARP is how to determine interface MAC address, knowing its IP address, okay? So this IP address is dynamically assigned through some DHCP servers or some sort of other machines. But obviously, for local area network communication, they require MAC address. So it is very simple. Every computer would be storing some sort of very small table. Remember, whenever we need mapping, we require a table on the internet, right? So it's a very general answer for you. So if someone is asking how this computer will know this address, you can just make a say that, okay, there would be a subtable. And in 99%, it would be correct. Your answer would be correct. Yes, we require table, some sort of mapping table, okay? Just like DNS works on mapping table, NAT is there, network address translation based on table, routers routing based on tables, and same is the case with ARP. ARP, your address resolution protocol is also based on table. And table is just a mapping, okay? For this thing, what is the MAC address of this local IP? So every computer would be, this ARP table, each IP node, host or router on LAN has table. So it would be storing very small table, and it could be a very small text file, okay? And we know that even on local area network, we wouldn't have so much big table, very small file of few KB, kilobytes, okay? So this table would contain IP MAC address mappings for some LAN nodes, okay? IP address, MAC address, TTL, time to live. Time to live is time after which address mapping will be forgotten, okay? Typically 20 minutes. So, so only three entries, this IP, MAC address and TTL. So for example, this is a local area network and we want to communicate, machine A wants to send datagram to machine B, this machine. So B's MAC address not in A's ARP table. Obviously, for example, it's just connected with this network first time. So A uses ARP to find B's MAC address. It's just a message, it will broadcast all machines. Okay, so it will ask what is your MAC address if your IP address is this one. Okay, this is very simple. So ARP table in A, it's empty at the moment, right? So A will broadcast ARP query containing B's IP address. Destination MAC address is this one. All nodes on LAN receive ARP query. So this, because this is broadcasted, so the word broadcasted means everyone received data. So C will receive this query, D will receive this query, and obviously B will also receive this query. And then Ethernet frame sent to this, and obviously this A broadcast its own MAC address as well. So this is all F, right? And source MAC is this one, source IP is this one, target IP address is this one, right? So you can see here, this one is, okay. So obviously this frame will be, B replies to A with ARP response giving its MAC address, okay? Its MAC address is this one, 5823D7FA20B0 something. So this will be sent to A. And obviously then A will store this information and it will add B's entry in ARP table in A. So that for future communication, it will know that, okay, for this particular IP address, the MAC address is this one, okay? And time to live, they will add time in 500 or it could be in seconds, it could be different, okay? So by this way, if they want to send again data, now they don't send ARP query, they will know that, okay, for this particular IP address, MAC address is this one. Same is the case if we have switch, all the traffic that ARP, and obviously when this A would be sending query to all, then C can store its data. C can store, okay, for this particular IP address, MAC address is this one. So by this way, C and D also will know that, okay, this is the MAC address of machine A. And if there is a switch in between these four machines, then obviously switch would also have an ARP table and they would be storing information of each computer with their MAC addresses. So Ethernet, obviously it's a dominant wired LAN technology. All over the world, people are using Ethernet technology, okay? And first, widely used LAN technology, simpler, and it's very cheap in terms of cost. And obviously you would have one-time cost. You have to set up these sort of all cables and then you have to place switches. We have option, but in most of the cases we are using switches. And its speed is high, 10 Mbps to 400 gigabits per second. And we have multiple options for Ethernet. Bus or coaxial cables were famous through mid 90s, but obviously then it was taken over by switch technology. So these switches are, everyone is using this switch technology in Ethernet. So active link to switch in center, each spoke runs a separate Ethernet protocols. So this is a switch. And obviously it would have some data frame in which they have to enter destination and source address and data payload and CRC sort of thing, okay? So address is 6 byte source destination MAC address. So just remember that for Ethernet, source addresses and destination addresses are MAC addresses, because over the Ethernet or local area networks uses MAC addresses to communicate, okay? And then the different purposes of different data for error detection, they have cyclic redundancy check at receiver end, CRC. Ethernet is connectionless. In terms of connectionless, just like TCP, it's not like TCP, no handshaking between sending and receiving NICs, okay? And unreliable. Obviously, they are broadcasting data, so receiving NIC doesn't send acknowledgments or NICs to sending NIC. Data in drop frames recovered only if initial sender uses higher rate RDT, for example, TCP. Otherwise, drop data lost, okay? So that's why in internet we are using TCP. So Ethernet uses MAC protocol named as CSMACD, carrier sense multiple access with collision detection, okay? Carrier sense is simply, we talked about this thing, that in carrier sense, firstly you have to check that link is available or not. If someone is sending data, then you have to wait it. So this is carrier sense. If there is no data going on link, then it will send it, okay? But there is a chance simultaneously two machines check, there is no one sending, and both at the time they can send. It is the possibility, then there would be collision, especially if the link is half duplex, then obviously this collision detection is there. And obviously, if because this network card, if two machines are sending data to me, then obviously there would be collision, okay? Because this is a network card physically connected, only one link is there. So I can only get data from one link, not from two machines or two nodes. So that's why this is collision. So there are different Ethernet standards according to the speed. 10 megabits or 100 megabits or 1 gigabits, it depends on different speed of the Ethernets, okay? And obviously if you require some higher physical links, then obviously you would require fiber physical link. So switch is a link layer device, takes an active role. So this is a switch that you can see here as well. So the purpose of switch is to store forward Ethernet frames, okay? It will examine incoming frames MAC address, selectively forward frame to one or more outgoing links when frame is to be forwarded on segment. So technically, in short, the main purpose of switch is to, because switch is also connected with the router, okay? So switch will determine, okay, this communication is for local area network or for outside world. If it is for outside world, then it will send data to the router. Then router will send data to the outside world, right? Same is the case if when our router will receive that thing, then router on the basis of subnetting or IP address subnetting it will know that, okay, this data is for this particular local area network, and it will send to the switch, and then switch will send it to the main one machine. Okay, so host unaware of presence of switches, plug and play, self-learning. So switches do not need to be configured. So whenever I would like, I can turn it off, and then when it will be up, it will start learning again on the basis of different ARP request. Okay, whenever these machine would be sending some data, it will store same like table, one table, and storing, okay, this particular machine has a MAC address of this one, and it's connected to me, right? So that this is self-learning. So multiple simultaneous transmissions are possible, because you can see that here different machines are connected to one switch. Host have dedicated direct connection to switch. So we discussed this thing that we have one direct dedicated link to this switch. Okay, so switches buffer packets, Ethernet protocol used on each incoming link so that no collisions and full duplex. Each link is its own collision domain. So for example, switching between A and A dash and B to B dash can transmit simultaneously without collisions, because there is a direct link which is possible, right? But obviously A to A dash or C to C dash cannot happen simultaneously, because now there would be collision. This machine is not capable of receiving data simultaneously from A and C as well. So that's why it's a collision, okay? So this switch will know that, okay, there is a collision and something. So there is one question. How does switch know A prime or A dash reachable via interface 4 and B reachable via interface 5? Okay, so answer is simple, that each switch would have a switch table. Okay, so it means that there is a table. It will know that if someone want to communicate with machine B, it's accessible through interface 2. Okay, so MAC address of host, interface to reach host, timestamp looks like a routing table. So how are entries created, maintained in switch table, something like a routing protocol? Technically, when they are sending ARP different request, the switch is storing that information here. Okay, so this is one small institutional network. It could be, you can consider it as a NUIG network. So for example, this is business school local area network, this is some sort of computer science or double E. Okay, and obviously we would have some proxy servers, mail servers are there, DNS server could also be there, DHCP would be there. Okay, and for this outside world to communicate for this network, we require a router, right? So for external communication, and this router would be connected with a router of a ISP, and then you can imagine that local ISP, regional ISPs are all interconnected. So by this way, we can easily communicate. So one more slide about routers and switches. Then we would have last topic of virtual LANs, and it's very easy because nowadays switches are very smart. They are capable of making different LANs. For example, there is one another campus of NUIG in some other part, and there is, right, in Shannon, right? Some sort of hotel management degree programs are there, right? So physically, it is not possible to make geographically separated entities to make one local area network, because there would be multiple routers in between them, right? But technically, they are part of one local area network, because they want For example, if there are some application based on intranet. So what is intranet? Can anyone tell? All of you know that internet, but what is intranet? Yeah, good, good. So we can say that some sort of local area network is intranet whenever we don't require router, right? Like, but the problem is for intranet is that if your device, if your area is geographically distributed in some other part of Ireland, but in terms of organization, you are one organization, then this sort of virtual LANs are required. So that although you are physically distributed, geographically distributed, but in terms of networks, you are part of same LAN, local area network, okay? So switches versus routers. So switches are for responsible for local area transmission. Routers are responsible for wider area or internet-based transmission, okay? So obviously both are store and forward. Routers, network layer devices, main difference is that it's a network layer device, and switch is a link layer device, okay? Both have forwarding tables. Routers compute tables using routing algorithms, IP addresses. Switches learn forwarding table using flooding, okay? Learning, and obviously it's based on MAC addresses. So this is the main difference. So flooding, what is flooding? Broadcasting is flooding. You are sending messages to everyone. It means that you are flooding data. And just remember that on local area network, there is no cost, as such cost of data transmission, because you have set up all the local area network physically, and obviously you would have a cost of something like running these cables and installing and purchasing switches. But once there is local area network is established, now you don't have to pay cost for communication within local area network, okay? But this is not the case for the internet. Whenever you are sending data outside world, you have to pay it. It just like that at home, there is no cost if you are. How many of you has sent data to your sister, brother, or friend on wireless network or some sort of transferred some files at home? Did anyone try or no? Or never? Or at least you have shared file through Bluetooth at least once in your life. It's now obsolete, Bluetooth or something, but 5 years ago or something, right? So it means that because there is no cost of sending data on Bluetooth if you are sharing information, because it's some sort of local area. So on local area, there is no cost sending data, right? So that's why flooding, there is no harm of flooding. You can send so much data and links are available, okay? So this is the main difference between routers and switches. And routers uses IP addresses, but switches uses MAC addresses. So one of the difference between this thing. And obviously router is a network layer device and switch is a link layer device. Any question between difference between switches and routers? So communication over the internet has some cost, okay? But communication over the intranet has no cost. I'm not considering about that implementation of local area. Obviously, you have to put resources and there is a cost, but transmission cost is not there, okay? Only cost is obviously your electricity and some other stuff, but as such, you don't have to pay your ISP if you want to send data locally. So that's why all the communication within NUIG, they would prefer to have intranet-based applications, not internet-based applications, okay? Because intranet-based application wouldn't charge them any cost in terms of data transmission. And it would be fast because they can install optical fibers or some very quick links. So one-time installation charges are there. Otherwise, there wouldn't be any as such cost, okay? So the last topic of this class is virtual LANs. So what happens as LAN sizes scale, users change point of attachment. For example, if someone is right now sitting here, for example, this is business school, and if I move to some computer science department, then obviously I am part of the same network, institutional network, right? So this sort of thing is that like I should remain same part of this LAN. So just like here, okay. And for example, if I'm moving from computer science to EE, but I also want to connect some printer in computer science, and there is a restriction that only this LAN people can use this computer, this printer here, then I need virtual LANs. Because now I am not technically part of this LAN, but I want, if I am connecting from here, then due to some reason, if I still want to part of this computer science LAN, then this would be resolved by virtual LANs, okay? So VPN sort of thing is also works similar to virtual LAN sort of thing, right? So that, for example, if I'm at home, obviously I wouldn't be part of NUIG, right? But if I want some resources, then I can use some sort of VPN or virtual LAN so that I would be sitting in different network or different local area network, but I can be part of NUIG as well, okay? So, So nowadays, this virtual LAN is possible based on ports. So switches supporting VLAN capabilities can be configured to define multiple virtual LANs over single physical LAN infrastructure. So nowadays switches have a capability, or they are running some sort of softwares so that they can make different virtual LANs. Just like for this switch, so it's a virtual LAN ports for 9 to 15 for CS, same is the case for EE. They assign different ports, and now people can connect with this port and operates as a virtual switch. So technically it's a one switch, but it will divide it, and then if they want to communicate with this one, they will make part of this virtual LAN port, okay? So by this way, they can easily communicate and remain part of this CS part, okay? So here, so this switch will be doing this work, okay? So it will be dividing this thing, but it has ports for virtual LAN. Okay, any question? So in terms of businesses, can anyone tell how internet, obviously, there is no doubt, like people would say, there is no use of internet in businesses. But what would be your expectation after taking this course in terms of internet or for in terms of business information system? Because some of the students are not from BIS background, but most of the students in this course are from BIS degree. So can anyone comment anything about internet? What is the link between internet and businesses if they want to communicate? Businesses, internet, or applications. Anyone? There are only few people. Like in class, how many students we have? In 50s, I think. In database, 61. 50. Okay. Okay, any question? Because this is the last lecture on layers, we have discussed application layer, transport layer, then network layer, and today we discuss link layer. And then from the next week, we would be discussing some sort of advanced topics in networks, for example, network security, firewalls. We also have to discuss wireless area networks, 3G or 4G sort of thing. And cloud computing is also there. So, yeah, 4 weeks. We can stop here if we don't have any question, but.